Welcome to another edition of County Connection. I'm your host, Berks County Commissioner Christian Leinbach. We have a very interesting program today, the spotted lanternfly. It's amazing, but I'm guessing many of you have never heard of the spotted lanternfly. I'd love to tell you that this was a Halloween joke, but it's not. It's serious, and it's here in Berks County and beyond. And our program today will focus on the history, the impact of the spotted lanternfly, and what we need to do to fight back. I have some guests in our audience today. First of all, Brian Walsh. Brian is a landscape contractor and a member of the advisory board for the Montgomery County Penn State Extension. Great to have you, Brian.
Thanks for having me.
And we also have Beth Finlay. Beth Finlay is with Penn State Extension, and she is the Master Gardener Coordinator and focuses on this region. Great to have you, Beth.
Thanks for having me. Good to be with you.
And then we have Stephanie Shirk, and Stephanie Shirk is the Client Relations Manager for Penn State Extension and also focused on this region.
Absolutely. Thank you, Commissioner, for having us all here today.
Great to have you. The one commonality among all four of us is all four of us have been dealing with the issue of the spotted lanternfly since the fall of 2014. It seems like it was almost yesterday when I got that first phone call. It was from Ed Overberger, district township supervisor, and he said, Commissioner Leinbach, have you gotten a call from the Pennsylvania Department of Ag about this spotted lanternfly thing? And I said, no. He told me what he knew, which was very little. And shortly after that, I got the call from the Pennsylvania Department of Ag, and the saga and crisis started. Now, we know, Beth and Stephanie and Brian, that it probably was here at least 1 or 2 years prior to that. 2014 is when it was first discovered by a game warden with the Pennsylvania State Game Commission. They were smart enough to recognize there was something very different that they hadn't seen before, and they reported it to the Department of Ag, and they became involved. I'd like, Beth, for you to take us a little bit, back a little bit into that history. When did Penn State get involved? And then let's look at the initial impact. We'll look at some maps and talk about where we are today.
Good. Well, once this insect was identified as something new and different in the area, Department of Ag immediately got involved. And very soon after that, Penn State was also called on. And so Penn State entomologists became involved, educators became involved, and it soon became apparent that this was not going to be a one-time sighting. This was very early recognized as a real issue with potential economic impact. So it started, if we look at the early maps of 2014, if we could put that up, you can see that this was first identified and pretty well localized.
All in Berks County.
Only in Berks County and all of the Western Hemisphere. Aren't we fortunate? But it was pretty well localized in the eastern part of Berks County, and the hope was that it could be contained there. And I have to say there was a valiant effort on the part of the Department of Ag and Penn State Extension to try to control it. And they did, in fact, slow the spread, I think, so they deserve credit for that. But despite best efforts, if we look at the 2016 map, Well, see, it's quite different by that time into 35 to 40 municipalities and townships and boroughs. And it was clear that it was not going to be an easy task.
Now, when in 2016, I know a lot of us expressed concern. This seemed, and it undoubtedly was, a significant increase. But one of the things we were told is that while this is the only location in the Western Hemisphere, it was an invasive that at last had been seen in South Korea. South Korea is about 38,000 square miles. I believe Pennsylvania is maybe 45, 46,000 square miles. In 3 years in South Korea, it covered the entire country of South Korea. We were told in 2016, we're doing better than we thought we would be doing. We thought it would be a multi-state. So I think to a certain degree, we said, okay, we've got this under control. But let's go to September of 2017.
Mm-hmm. And truly, I don't think anybody ever thought we could totally contain it. But we did.
Let's bring up the map for, there it is.
Yeah, that's the most recent map, and there'll be a new one out in a matter of weeks that probably will show still further expansion.
Yeah, and Beth, when we look at this, it was this summer, and Brian may have a little bit different perspective on this, and we'll get to him when we talk about on the ground, but it was this summer that to many of us, myself included, I said, whoa, this thing has gone to a whole new level. And towards the end of the summer, beginning of September, all of a sudden, we saw them on the 13th floor of the County Services Center balcony. Now, first of all, they weren't supposed to be able to fly. They're not flies. They're in the leafhopper family. And that is several hundred feet in the air. And we observed them out away from the balcony flying. Mm-hmm. When we saw them in downtown Reading, we realized we have Norfolk Southern, east, west, north, south. We have 90,000 people. Up until that point in time, it wasn't really in major populated areas. That's changed. And it is an explosion, but it is still limited to this region of Pennsylvania. It may expand beyond that in the new numbers, but right now it's in Pennsylvania. The only other places in the world that exists is Southeast Asia, where it's native, China, Vietnam, I think the Philippines, and invasive in Japan and South Korea.
Right.
We'll talk about the damage in a minute, but we are in a real battle, and the rest of the world is looking to see what we're able to do to
Absolutely.
Fight this in our area.
Absolutely. And one of the important things for Berks Countyans to recognize is that while this insect is capable of flying, it's not flying for hundreds of miles.
No.
The way it's going to move into new areas is by hitching a ride, mostly with people, on vehicles, mm-hmm. on materials that are moved about.
Well, I would say two ways. Yes, that is the big one, especially to move great distances. But if it is not dealt with on a perimeter strongly, it can move pretty rapidly. And that's what we observed. No one saw it in Reading. It was on Mount Penn, and literally all of a sudden one day it shows up on the streets of Reading. Mm-hmm. So it's significant. Before we go to Brian, and exclusively any of us, let's talk about why it's such a threat. The grape operations in South Korea were wiped out as a result of the spotted lanternfly. We are seeing some very serious damage in the grape areas in the quarantine now. We've observed, I personally have observed, vineyards that are spraying to the max allowed. And they will spray and kill hundreds of thousands. And within days in the adult area, that's pretty much August through the first several hard frosts, hundreds of thousands of more are back in several days. More importantly, nitrogen levels are through the roof, sugar levels are in the basement, and it makes the product almost unmarketable. We've seen them in apples. That was new. I actually was with Penn State Extension and Pennsylvania Department of Ag. But it can destroy grapes, destroy hops. It appears to be very damaging to black walnut, to maple. I think it's shagbark.
Sugar maple. And silver maple.
And silver maple.
That's what our researchers are finding, that it's no longer just going to the tree Atlantis, of heaven
my tree
or the Atlantis.
The tree of
it's
heaven.
It's now finding other hosts to be able to
And the issue there
find its,
is hardwood. Mm-hmm. Pennsylvania is the number one producer and exporter of hardwood, definitely in the country, possibly in the world. And we're at risk of having our grapes quarantined, losing the industry, losing the hops industry, severe damage to the hardwood industry. This is a huge, huge problem.
There's another angle, too,
sure.
that hasn't been touted much as an economic factor, but I think we're going to see it in real estate. There are properties.
Absolutely.
Whose properties are just covered with these right now, and the waste that they excrete and the sugary sap.
The honeydew that they secrete.
The honeydew.
Well, I think that's a great transition to Brian. Brian has some images that are quite frankly disturbing, and I'd like people to think of two things, especially with your comment, Beth, and we'll go with that first. How would you handle this in your backyard? How would you handle picnics with tens of thousands of flying adults landing on you? They don't sting, they don't bite, but they are a nuisance. And more than a nuisance, it makes it almost impossible in hot spots to enjoy any outdoor activity. Brian, you've seen this firsthand. Can you take us through and kind of tell us what we're looking at and the damage and the various issues. Let's go ahead with the slides.
Okay. The first slide there, that is looking at the ground beneath a silver maple tree that was systemically treated. And as waves of adults kept moving in, they would feed on the tree, ingest the insecticide, and drop to the ground. And you can see just by the sheer number on the ground that left unchecked in that tree, it's going to bleed that tree down to nothing. Mm-hmm. And
what exactly are they doing? What are they feeding on?
They are phloem feeders. Phloem is the sap in the tree. And that's the lifeblood of the tree that transports all the sugars down to the ground for the following year. So that feeding action of that phloem, it's basically like if you were to be tapped giving blood constantly, nonstop, sooner or later it's going to bleed you down and something else is going to take over here. That's an image of an adult female. And you can see she's all puffed out in the abdomen, getting ready to lay eggs. She did ingest on a treated tree, so her wings are open, split open, and she can't control them once she eats the dinotefuran. So that's a good indication that what we did worked. This image is some egg masses, some older egg masses beneath. If you look, you can see the outline of the adults, and then you see the little blotch there underneath, and that is an egg mass, and they blend really well. That's a fresh egg mass. So you can see when they first lay, they're really easy to pick out. You can get out there, you can scrape them, but once they start to dry back in an hour or so, they're tough to spot.
You mentioned scraping them. They're laying eggs and have been laying eggs. Shortly, when we get some hard freezes, all the adults will be dead. And one of the strategies that does work is scraping egg masses. How do you do that?
Any way you can, and you just literally pop them. We have scraper cards.
Yeah, if you want to zoom in on this scraper that we have right here.
This is an effort from Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture and Penn State Extension. They put out these, it's almost like a credit card, plastic card.
She's gonna get it.
And it has instructions on the back to search for the egg masses. And then you just scrape it from the surface. You want to make sure all the seed-like black, brown eggs from under the wax coating are scraped away.
And people put them in Ziploc bags?
Yes, you're supposed to double bag them and then take it to the trash, burn and submerge, or submerge the eggs in alcohol is another
way.
So you just use it to scrape
but
away.
But don't just put them in a bag and throw it in regular trash. Either burn it or submerge them in alcohol.
Yes. Yes.
So egg masses.
If you're not squeamish, you can just get in there and smush them, and it's actually quite satisfying at this point.
And people that haven't lived with hundreds of thousands of them
and have not,
can't appreciate
and
that the only good spotted lanternfly is a dead spotted lanternfly.
People who have not endured the honeydew, which is the excrement, raining down upon them like a drizzle.
Like rain.
Yeah. Yeah, that's when they start taking it personal. That is the tree that we saw previous. That is the same tree after the first wave hit, and that's what's laying dead on the ground. So then you can see with each wave that hit, they more would feed and die and pile up. That's a kind of cool picture. That was where a customer had used tape to catch the nymphs, the young ones, crawling up the tree, and this particular nymph got stuck in the tape and then decided it was time to molt and get out of there and become an adult. And so when they first molt, that's the color that they are when they crack out of their shell. That picture is how they congregate on masonry around houses on a cool morning. They are cold-blooded, so they will find a warm spot to congregate. They're not trying to get in your house. They may get in your house, but really what they're doing is just using the structure and the warmth. That's a male and a female that are locked together when they're mating, and they stay stuck like that, so that's a good time to get out there with a fly swatter and swat them because they're not real.
Well, let's talk about that. These things, they may not be big-time flyers. No, you don't need to go back, but people that try to step on them, they just shoot. They take off.
There's a great trick to that.
Let's get the trick.
And I have to credit Miss Chris, one of my kids' teachers, for pointing it out. When they first land, they're disoriented, and it'll take them a second or two to get their footing again. So when they land is when you can really step on them easily. When they first, when you get close and they've had a moment, they'll spring and they'll take off, and they're kind of tough to catch.
Yeah, they are.
But it takes a little practice, and you get good at it.
Some additional photos.
So that's what a tree looks like before the feeding starts. And so you can understand why people are very upset and very concerned when they walk out their back door. One day that tree was clear, and the next day they have this situation. And that's that same tree again, as that pile just kept getting bigger and deeper, and it doesn't smell good. If you leave it there, it starts to rot down. Again, property values. There's that nymph that was molting, another shot of that. That is a late stage nymph. So they're easier to see at this stage because it's the only time that they're not just black with white spots.
Real quickly, take us through, this is, just back up a second. Take us through the stages quickly. Right now, when they're really troublesome and more noticeable is the adult.
Yeah.
But they're hatched out normally late April, early May, after several days of 70 degrees or more. Just take us real quickly through those stages.
So those eggs are going to hatch out. They're going to be black with white spots. And in the first instar, I don't have good pictures because I wasn't thinking that hard back this spring, but they're almost like fleas. They're tough to see. They spring. They do not have wings. They cannot fly. But I've been in yards that were so infested that I had to take my boots off when I was leaving and shake them out. That in and of itself can freak you out. Just the sheer numbers. Those are old egg masses that had hatched, and you can see that covering is no longer there. It's worn away. You can see the eggs are open. There's little slits in the top sides. Mm-hmm. They've hatched out. So those are old egg masses. They're not hurting anything. Scrape them while you're there. Another shot of older egg masses and an adult. This is sooty mold. This is what happens when all that lanternfly excrement lands down below. It's extremely sugar rich. You think maple syrup is high sugar content, and most other trees are high sugar content. That lands on whatever's below it as these guys pee it out, and then sooty mold grows, which is a fungus that just takes over, and it is obnoxious. In some cases, if there's landscaping beneath, it will grow over the leaves, stop them from being able to photosynthesize and actually kill the plants. If it's over your deck, Trex decking is porous. It is very, very difficult to get out.
It almost creates a slick
barrier
on anything.
Yep.
So. And people have described it as walking around under trees where the spotted lanternflies, adults are, that it just rains on them. Mm-hmm. It is.
You can see it coming down.
Very.
In a bad spot, I'll actually put a raincoat on to just to be under it. Yeah. I'm not squeamish, but this is it can get very obscene and and overwhelming. So
let's put up the contact information and let's talk about what do you do if you see a spotted lanternfly and you believe you're in an area that isn't supposed to have them. We have an information slide with a website. It is the website, if we can bring it up, for the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture. The website is at the top. The email is badbug@pa.gov. And the phone number, if you want to talk to somebody to find out what to do, maybe you have them and you know you're in the quarantine zone, but you want to know what to do, contact those numbers. There are things that we can do to respond. In the 5 minutes that are left, and I told you this goes very quickly, I think we all agree we absolutely have an ecological and an economic crisis. Ecological, we're dealing with an invasive that goes after an invasive in the Atlantis tree or the tree of heaven, but unfortunately goes after a wide range of valuable economic resources, grapes, hops, hardwood, orchards, and it is having a tremendous negative effect, quality of life issues. We recently participated, or at least I attended, a hearing in Harrisburg that was hosted on the spotted lanternfly, and we heard about some of the same information. One thing that was shared by Secretary Redding, he was asked, how much money is it going to take? And he said, estimated $40 million jointly from the federal government and the state government. I'm going to ask you to jump in here, but this is the way I see it, and I am not being melodramatic. We are on the verge of a crisis. We have an invasive in this part of Pennsylvania that doesn't exist, as far as we know, anywhere in the Western Hemisphere. We know that all U.S. ports are watching and testing for the spotted lanternfly, and you can bet there are ports probably all across the world doing that. It's not in Europe. It's not in the Mideast. It's in Southeast Asia, Japan, and South Korea. It has the potential to fundamentally alter the economics of a variety of products that we have here in Pennsylvania.
As well as our landscape.
As well as our landscape.
Food systems and absolutely building
everything.
Industries.
Our quality of life. Mm-hmm. I believe we need an immediate joint response, federal and state, Department of Ag, U.S. Forest Service, DCNR is already involved. There needs to be a coordinated effort. We need dollars, and we also need the personnel. And we need it now because we've got to deal with the issues that are in front of us. We need to deal with the egg masses, and we need to prepare for the battle that we're going to face come spring.
Absolutely.
We can't wait till then. What are your thoughts to the extent that you feel comfortable commenting?
I think you bring up a lot of good points, Commissioner, and what we can do for the public to help educate them is a lot of efforts with the Master Gardeners. We have the largest volunteer network across the state of Pennsylvania. We're in all 67 counties. So it's very much affecting us here in Berks County, Montgomery, Lehigh. It's been spotted in Lancaster County. If it hits Adams County, that's the majority of our apple industry in the state of Pennsylvania. We need to educate the public this winter. It is critical.
But we need the public's help.
Absolutely.
In educating our legislators at the state and federal level, our governor, and our president.
Yes, you've got to take it one step further. Once they know, we need your help.
And we need them to jump on this now. Brian, your thoughts.
Two thoughts. $40 million in the face of this is like a fire extinguisher at a wildfire. Knowing what labor and overhead costs and the cost of these chemicals to treat these trees, it's a drop in the bucket.
Except all that's been spent so far, and I know everyone has done the best they could with what they had, but we're only a little over $5 million expended over 14, 15, 16, and 17.
would you rather spend the money on the front side or try and play catch up for the rest of eternity here? Yeah. This is not going to get better. It's only going to get worse, short of one miraculous concept, and that would be a population collapse. And I don't see it happening. I see this thing getting worse exponentially. We cannot rely on the unicorn theory that it might collapse. We need to take massive action. And as far as getting the people out there to do it, I think we need to engage the public, we need to get them organized, and we need to tell them the best methods and how they can help to deal with this. Egg mass scraping, treating their trees, do it in a
trap trees.
Trap trees. We really do need to get the public out there, and most of them want to help, they're just not sure what to do.
Well, I hope that you have been informed. Normally I say enjoyed. I hope you didn't enjoy this program, but have been informed. And we need your help. We need you to reach out to your state house, state senate members, to the governor, to your congressmen, to your senators, and to the president, and let them know we need dollars, we need boots on the ground, and we need a unified effort to attack the spotted lanternfly today. Thank you for tuning in. I'm your host, Christian Leinbach, saying thank you for joining us for another edition of County Connection.